Thanks to Magellan TV for sponsoring today's video. If I have seen further, it is by standing on the shoulders of giants. Just like with Isaac Newton, the Apollo program did not stand alone. Its achievements would not have been possible if it had not been for the important missions that ran before it and alongside it. It built on the understanding learned from those missions, expanded on their technology, and drew on the expertise of the people who worked on them. I'm Alex McColgan, and you're watching Astrum. Join with me today as we examine two of those vital early programs, Project Mercury and Project Gemini, and investigate how they helped a fledgling NASA to gain a greater understanding of how to put a man on the moon. I hope by the end of this video to have earned your like and subscription. NASA as an institution has not been around forever. It was only created in 1958 in response to the Soviet Union launching the Sputnik satellite about a year earlier. However, it's not accurate to say that NASA was completely new even in 1958. When US President Eisenhower signed off on the formation of NASA, he did it by combining several already existing programs and institutions. There was the NACA, the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics, the US Army's Ballistic Missile Agency, and German scientists who had worked on ballistic missiles for Germany during World War II. Beyond that, the US Air Force had been working on a Man in Space Soonest, or MISS program, which was also given to NASA, along with some of their facilities. These, alongside other government projects, provided the foundation for NASA. However, amongst all of these, there wasn't a way to get a human into orbit. The closest was the X-15 program of NACA. The aeroplane was able to skim the edges of space, and in the early 1960s broke records by flying to a height of 105 kilometers and achieving speeds of over 6,000 kilometers per hour. A later X-15 broke 7,200 kilometers per hour and holds the record to this day for the fastest crewed-powered aircraft. However, while this was above the Kármán line of 100 kilometers, or the FIA's definition of space, this really is the limit of an airplane. Something more would need to be developed to get a human into orbit, and ultimately to the moon. And so NASA began its first project to get a human properly into space, Project Mercury. Project Mercury's mission was a continuation of the Man in Space Soonest program. And as that name suggests, its objective was to get a man into orbit and back safely, ideally before the Soviet Union. This would not be an easy task. Riding a rocket into space meant an astronaut would need to deal with G-forces, intense vibrations, the risk of explosion from riding on what was basically a repurposed missile, and the threat of catastrophic burning up on re-entry. Scientists also worried about radiation once an astronaut left the atmosphere, and even micrometeors striking the ship. While some of these threats proved to be negligible, the odds of being hit by a meteor turned out to be very small, the rest were very real dangers to a human life. The rockets NASA used for Project Mercury were the Redstone rocket, which was later replaced by the Atlas rocket. Both of these rockets were originally designed as missiles. The Redstone was a direct descendant of the German V-2 rocket developed for use in war. When the Second World War ended, America brought German scientists over and put them to work developing American weapons and technology.
Werner von Braun, a German scientist brought over in this way, became a chief engineer at NASA,
and was instrumental in helping develop the rocket technology for Project Mercury and later Apollo. The idea was for a launch vehicle to carry a pod up to a height of 161 kilometers, shedding boosters and unneeded sections along the way. The pod would orbit the Earth, getting as high as 280 kilometers at the highest point in its orbit, before using its boosters to re-enter the Earth's atmosphere. After surviving the frictional heat of re-entry, which got as hot as 1,600 degrees Celsius, parachutes would open and slow the pod's landing in the ocean, where it would be retrieved. Boosters would need to jettison at the correct time to keep the weight down. This didn't always happen. They were trying out new ablative heat shields. Rather than completely prevent heat absorption, ablative heat shields absorbed a large amount of heat
and then burned it off as a gas, carrying the excess heat with it. Obviously, if you miscalculated how much heat shield you would need, your craft would run out and you'd burn up. Redundancies would need to be built into the rocket in the event of a malfunction while there was a human on board. A rocket-powered escape vehicle was built into the spacecraft as a kind of ejector seat. The whole process had to be thoroughly tested before they could try out a manned mission. The first effort in August 1959 did not go well. Due to an incorrectly installed power plug, the first Mercury Redstone rocket, known as Little Joe 1, only got about 4 inches off the ground before dropping back down on the landing pad. Future launches had mixed results.
Von Braun ran 20 tests in all between 1959 and 1961. Most of these tests were not crewed, except for a few where trained monkeys and chimpanzees occupied the pod. Von Braun wanted to be absolutely sure of success before allowing a human to go up in one of his rockets. While his caution was excellent scientific practice, it came at a price. In April 1961, Russia beat America to the punch by successfully launching astronaut Yuri Gagarin into orbit, making him the first man in space. Von Braun's first human launch came 1 month later with astronaut Alan Shepard, although this was still only a suborbital flight. 2-0 for the Russians. They got the first satellite into space and now the first human into orbit, and the US was worried.
Project Mercury ended up launching 6 human flights, 2 on Redstone rockets and 4 on Atlas rockets, all of which were successful. And although they didn't get into space soonest, as had been their goal, they learned incredibly important things about launching rockets, enduring space, and surviving re-entry. However, when NASA announced the Apollo program in 1960 with its intention to reach the moon, it became clear that far more knowledge would be needed. Mercury had seen its final mission put an astronaut in space for a day and a half, but a trip to the moon and back would take 8 days. Also, NASA decided the best way to get to the moon would be to use the Lunar Orbit Rendezvous method. The plan required them to perform perhaps the most difficult maneuver in space travel, docking with another object in orbit. They hadn't even achieved this around Earth yet, let alone the moon. The Lunar Orbit Rendezvous method consisted of a lunar module detaching from a command and service module, landing on the moon, then meeting back up with the command and service module, which would then take all the astronauts back to Earth. Astronauts would also need to practice doing spacewalks, in case work on the outside of a spacecraft became necessary during transit. And finally, more practice would be needed with re-entry techniques, particularly touching down at a pre-selected location on land, although in the Apollo missions this last idea was dropped. On top of that, the Soviet Union was ahead, and America needed to catch up. So while the Apollo team set to work developing its rockets and modules, these extra challenges were handed off to a support mission to work out. The mission was given the name Project Gemini. Project Gemini, which launched 12 missions between 1961 and 1966, built on the foundations of Project Mercury. The Gemini capsule was essentially a larger version of the one used on Mercury, now able to hold a crew of 2. The rocket used was a Titan II, another adapted military missile redesigned for a new purpose of discovery. Gemini also saw an expansion on that technology. For Project Mercury, the Mercury spacecraft could do little to redirect itself once it made it into orbit. If a space rendezvous was going to happen, this would need to change. The Gemini spacecraft was given an orbit attitude and maneuvering system to allow it to change its orbit and orient while in space. The Gemini spacecraft was also developed to be able to support a crew in space for longer. By the launch of Gemini 5, astronauts were able to spend an entire week in space. To play it safe, in later flights this time was extended to 14 days by Gemini 7, 6 more days than would be required for a trip to the moon. While there was a lot of success with these missions, there were some scares too. Neil Armstrong flew on Gemini 8. The purpose of this mission was to meet up with and dock with an uncrewed Agena target vehicle, which had been launched earlier. The first part of the mission went smoothly, with the docking being a success. But while Armstrong and his co-pilot David Scott were still in the target vehicle, they noticed that the ship had started spinning in space. This could be catastrophic. If the spinning ship hit their Gemini ship while the two attempted to undock, it could cause fatal damage to their craft. Furthermore, they were not exactly sure why the craft was spinning. If a thruster was firing when it shouldn't be, then it would be using up valuable fuel, fuel that was needed to orient themselves for the correct way for re-entry. If they were not facing the right way, the heat shield would not protect them from the incredible heat generated. The two astronauts worked quickly, and by firing one of the opposing thrusters, they were able to slow the two crafts enough that they were able to get back into the Gemini craft and just about undock safely. They realized then that it had been one of the Gemini craft's thrusters that had been firing. Both astronauts were close to passing out, however they managed to fix the fault, and using the re-entry thrusters, Armstrong calmly got the craft back under control, stopping its tumble. He managed it with only 30% fuel remaining. Moments like this reinforce the importance of being able to perform EVAs, or extravehicular activities. And so, Gemini also saw missions where astronauts practiced going outside of their spacecraft to perform checks. Buzz Aldrin set the record for this, performing a 5-hour 30-minute spacewalk, proving that, with proper rests, work outside of a spacecraft was indeed possible. This also gave engineers ideas on ways they could make it easier, such as installing handholds at certain places on the craft. All in all, it was through the work of Gemini and Mercury that the foundation was laid. Thanks to the discoveries made on both of these programs, NASA was making strides in its objectives to reach the moon. It also started to close the gap between it and Russia. It would now be up to Apollo to take the last steps. Join me in the next episode where we will look at the first Apollo missions that led up to the famous Apollo 11. Want a more in-depth look into the Gemini program and how it helped prepare the way for Apollo? Well, there's a great documentary on Magellan TV called Gemini and Apollo that looks at the individual missions in detail. Some of these missions didn't all go to plan, and actually, the Apollo mission was nearly scrapped altogether due to the problems that were faced. If you want to check this documentary out for free, as well as gain access to Magellan TV's entire library of documentaries, you can use my link in the description to get a month's free trial. I really like this documentary, and there are thousands more on their platform about a host of different topics, which you can watch on nearly any device, so I really recommend checking it out. Thanks for watching. I hope you liked the video. If you did, please consider subscribing for more. Thank you as well to my patrons and members for supporting the channel. If you want to support too, check the links in the description. All the best, and see you next time.